Good morning, everybody. Buongiorno. Welcome to the first full day of the Calandra Institute's 11th annual conference. My name is Anthony Tambury, and I'm the dean of the Institute, and I'm happy to welcome you. These conferences seem to get more exciting. I'm not going to use any evaluative adjectives. I'm going to use instead those such as more exciting, more intriguing, and it's really wonderful to see this work going on. We have become part of a greater network now of diaspora studies. We were in Australia at the beginning of the month, and we're coming back here in November for a part of that series, and then the third and final leg of that series of conferences will be in Genova in June of 2019. So if you're not on our listserv, get on it so you can see the announcements of everything when all this happens. And so I'm going to give this over now to the chair of the session.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome. I would like to introduce our first presenter. ALFRED CRUDALE is a professor of Italian at the University of Rhode Island. He graduated from the University of Connecticut with a PhD in medieval Italian literature. The title of his dissertation is Love and Civitas, Dante's Ethical Journey in the Vita Nuova. His essay, entitled Versi d'Amore e Prose di Romanzi, Are the Poets of the Dolce Stil Nuovo Still Relevant?, was published in the International Journal of the Humanities, and his latest essay, Canzone t'ho allevato per figliuola d'amore, Three Songs of Love in Dante's Vita Nuova, was recently published in the Proceedings of the Dante and Music Conference. He is presently working on a book project which examines the history of Italian language newspapers and radio programs in Rhode Island. Professor Crudale's presentation today is entitled The Body Damned, The Body Saved, The Body Glorified, Portrayals of the Body in Dante's Commedia. Let's please welcome ALFRED CRUDALE.
Before I begin, I would like to thank all the people who put this wonderful conference together. I was here at last year's conference, and it was just a magnificent gathering of great minds. So to Anthony and Joseph and all the people who work behind the scenes, grazie. So in the interest of time, I won't read the quotes, but I will project them so that you'll have access to them. The human body throughout history has served as a fundamental element of the arts. From the classic period to modern age, painters and sculptors, writers and poets, musicians and photographers have found inspiration in the body, whether as a subject or metaphor. We think of Aristophanes' description of the body in Plato's Symposium, the eroticized bodies of Caravaggio's young males, or the distorted surrealist bodies of Salvador Dalí. Such depictions of the body create a metaphysical relationship which enables the artist to reveal the materiality of the body, namely the body as ideal versus the body as real. Saunders, Moore, and McNaughton remind us that throughout the centuries, writers have used the body as, quote, a primary subject intimately connected with the realization of human experience, end quote. This quote brings to mind the works of Dante Alighieri, and especially his Commedia, in which the realization of human experience is quite intimately connected to the body. Dante's concept of the contrapasso, in which the sinner's punishment is based on a specific aspect of his sin, provides the reader with an image of the nature of that sin, which is revealed through the body of the sinner. Thus, it becomes a visual manifestation through which the reader is able to comprehend not only the sin, but the punishment as well. This essay focuses on Dante's use of the body as a metaphor for the actions of the soul while it was alive. Through select canti, I examine the depiction of and forms of the body in the Inferno, Purgatorio, and the Paradiso, and discuss how they reveal Dante's political and philosophical beliefs. Following the pilgrim's journey beginning in hell, the naked body is the fundamental feature of both the damned and the demons. From the moment Dante enters hell, he notices that no one save Virgil and himself are clothed. The pilgrim first encounters the souls of the cowards and reports that questi sciurati che mai non fur vivi erano ignudi. Thus, the poet creates a link between the nakedness of the damned and their endless, shameful humiliation. The connection between humiliation and nudity is intensified when the pilgrim reaches the second circle of the inferno, where the lustful are punished. The sinners of this circle are buffeted by an endless, violent wind, but their bodies, unlike the sinners in lower hell, are not mutilated or distorted, and thus they are easily recognizable. Following a list of the peccator carnali che la ragion sottomettono al talento, Dante asks to speak with two souls who the reader learns are Francesco da Rimini and Paolo Malatesta. Due to the intensity of their passion and the circumstances of their death, the poet portrays them as two bodies which can never be separated from one another. The words of the poet underscore how the physical beauty of the two lovers drew them together, but also how the same beauty became their undoing. In true amor cortese fashion, the beautiful Francesca catches the eye of her handsome young lover, whose heart is immediately seized. Unlike the rest of the Inferno, Dante, the poet, seems to be celebrating the natural beauty of the human body. True to Platonic thought, Dante creates a link between beauty and love. Through Francesca's words, and this is the first quote, the poet emphasizes the physical beauty of the female form with its powerful ability to attract and capture the heart of her lover. Francesca, however, readily admits to the pilgrim that she too was smitten by the handsome Paolo, and that's the second quote. The poet juxtaposes the verb amar with the noun piacere to emphasize that love should not lead to excessive pleasure, but instead beauty should lead the lover to virtue. While the poet reveals the link between beauty and love, he also emphasizes, through the example of Paolo and Francesca, that love without the guiding light of reason can only lead to error and sadness. Physical beauty causes them to love so strongly that they abandon all reason and are condemned to suffer the ceaseless hurricane in the circle of the lustful. As the pilgrim descends through the infernal circles, the punishments and torments cause the bodies of the damned to become less recognizable. In the seventh circle, the poet describes the landscape as a desert besieged by an endless rain of fire, upon which the inhabitants, the sodomites, walk along the bank of the river Phlegeton, their bodies baked brown and burnt. Dante and Virgil walk atop the bank of the river, when suddenly a soul reaches out to tug on the pilgrim's robe. The pilgrim recognizes the charred soul as Brunetto Latini, his former teacher, and Dante is stunned to find his former mentor here in the fiery desert. In this circle of the Inferno, there comes a change of position as the former student, who is now on top, lowers his face to the face of his former teacher, who now occupies the bottom position. And this is the quote, "E io quando." The vicinity of their two bodies reveals an intimacy with which both are quite comfortable. The pilgrim admits to fixing his gaze on the brown, baked features of the damned soul and placing his own face close enough to potentially kiss his former master. The term conoscenza conveys a double entendre, for while the pilgrim does in fact recognize Ser Brunetto, the term also suggests a carnal familiarity which surpasses a simple recognition of the face. The homoerotic symbolism of the scene is essential to understanding the poet's treatment of the sodomites in the circle of hell. Rather than condemnation, the poet seems to treat these sinners against nature with empathy and respect. Yes, he places them on a burning desert and torments them with rain of fire, burning and distorting their bodies to the point of nudo e dipelato. His speech and interaction with them, however, betrays the poet's compassion. The reader experiences the poet's affection in the pilgrim's offer to rest a while with Brunetto, who he then later in the canto fondly lavishes with praise. The terms demando and umana natura reinforce the homoerotic tone of the canto, but the pilgrim also refers to his former mentor with cara, buona, and paterna, adjectives of affection and endearment. The benign treatment of Brunetto Latini prepares the reader for the following canto, in which the pilgrim encounters other sodomites to whom he extends his compassion. Having cried out to Dante to stop and speak with them, the poet describes the effects of their punishment on the bodies of these damned souls. And that's the next quote I make. The searing flames ravish their naked bodies, scarring them with new wounds on top of old wounds. Later in the canto, the reader learns that the rain of fire has burned away their skin, the organ of the body which protects all others. Our skin separates our inner organs from the world around us. Sensors in and under the skin enable us to feel pain or pleasure, as when someone pinches us or when we are caressed. While our skin protects us from the infections and other diseases, it also contributes to our identity. The color of one's skin reveals race. Just as wrinkles or lack of may help determine age, the tint or hue of our skin may help determine health. Addle C. Williams argues that, quote, the skin is our most sensitive means of interaction with the world, and yet somehow still seems to be the barrier to our deeper immersion in it, end quote. Here in the seventh circle, nudo e dipelato, the organs of the sodomites are exposed to the incessant blistering heat as a result of their inability to control and master their unwanted desire while alive. Even here, however, the poet Dante treats these sinners almost reverently as we hear Virgil instruct the pilgrim, "Ora aspetta, a costoro si vuole essere cortese." Soon after Dante compares these souls to campioni nudi e unti, a vivid contrast to their misery and tortured aspects. Finally, upon interacting with his interlocutors, the pilgrim divulges his desire to jump down from the riverbank and embrace the sodomites. Excited by the erotic scene of the naked sodomites dancing about on the hot desert sand, the pilgrim admits his desire to join them and acknowledges that Virgil, a pederast and sodomite himself, would allow such participation. It is the fear, however, of being baked and burnt which gives pause to Dante's homoerotic desires. Reason causes him to concede that fear of the punishment outweighs the joy of the pleasure. Feltham and Miller state, quote, paura is typically opposed to desio in Dantean psychology, end quote. As is evident in the term paura being placed in contrast to buona voglia. And thus, despite his eagerness to embrace these souls, the pilgrim suppresses his desire and continues his journey. Passing from the depths of hell to the mountain of purgatory, the reader notices that corporeal depictions of the souls are as vivid and engaging as they were in the inferno, less the darkness and suffering. The images of the purgatorio create an atmosphere of hope and optimism as the pilgrim begins his ascent toward paradise. Unlike the shameful and distorted nakedness of hell, the naked bodies on this mountain island reflect a cleansing rejuvenation as the penitents bear their burdens with the knowledge that they are working toward their entrance into glory. In Canto 23, Dante comes upon a group of souls so gaunt that their skins take on the shape of their bones. These are the gluttons, who in life were unable to control their insatiable appetite and who now cleanse their souls through emaciating hunger and thirst. While the poet describes the bodies of these penitents, it is their faces which draw his greatest attention and through which he presents his reader the essence of humanity. In this stanza, which is the first quote there, in this stanza, the poet directs his reader's thoughts to the face of the other, for it is the face which reveals our humanity. Dante suggests that in the face one reads homo, the Latin word for man, as the eyes form the two O's and the eyebrows and nose form the letter M. Much more than a poetic device, the poet emphasizes the face as the one feature of our body which declares our humanity. When we speak of the faceless masses, we conjure up an immense crowd, almost inhuman and unknowable. Likewise, the phrase, it's good to put a name with a face, reinforces the notion that a faceless name is nothing more than a generic label. Only after the label has been assigned to a specific face does the person identified by that label become truly human? The French philosopher Emmanuel Levinas concludes that the face of the other commands me to relation and orders me as responsible for my neighbor. He writes, quote, his face, the expressive in the other, were what ordains me to serve him. The face orders and ordains me, end quote. Thus, our responsibility for our neighbor emanates from the face, which commands us to action, for the ethics of the face forces us to respond to the humanity of the other. In his conversation with Forese Donati in the Purgatorio, the pilgrim does respond to the emaciated penitents, greatly sympathizing with their plight and exposing a deep pathos on Dante's part. Okay, this is La Faccia Tu is the next quote. Forese's distorted face represents all the gluttons, and Dante's lament over Forese's pain is thus extended to all the souls of this terrace. The terms lacrimar, piangere, and torta underscore Dante's pathos, which is aroused by the sunken eyes of Forese's face. Ed ecco del profondo della testa volse a me gli occhi di un'ombra. The sunken eyes of the soul emphasize the two O's of the Latin homo, and thus focuses the reader's attention on the humanity of these penitents. Through the face of the gluttons, Dante reminds the readers that we are all human, and that while we may be led astray, our humanity, the essence of our being, is always present and visible. Unlike the first two cantiche, there are no naked bodies in the Paradiso, as the souls in heaven are clothed in light. In Canto 1, the poet's description of the heavenly light, which grows increasingly brighter, prepares the reader for the intensity which will be experienced both visually and aurally as the pilgrim approaches the Imperium. The first example comes in the first canto of the Paradiso, when the pilgrim sees the sun, which, due to its great brilliance, he must look at through Beatrice's eyes. Okay, so I will discuss these next two quotes. In the terms sfavillar, ferro che bolliente, and fuoco, the poet presents the reader with images which capture our sight and draw our vision, as anyone who has ever seen a piece of steel removed from the fire will attest. One's eyes are drawn to the glowing steel, almost unable to turn away. Similarly, the image of sparks, molten iron, and fire draw the reader's attention, causing us to focus on the brightness of the scene. Reading is an activity which depends on the eyes. Thus, Dante's vivid imagery is fundamental to the total economy of the poem, for as we read, we see. The luminosity of the sun, however, is too much for the pilgrim, and he turns away from the blinding light to view the burning orb through the eyes of Beatrice, who, the poet recounts, gazed intently at l'eterne rote. The eye is the organ which enables us to experience beauty, which, as Plato believed, beauty leads us to the summum bonum. It is then through Beatrice's eyes, which reflect the light and harmony of heaven, that the pilgrim is led toward God. This episode is a foreshadowing of the scene in which Dante will see God. The human eye is incapable on its own of withstanding the luminosity of the heavenly spheres. Thus, the glorified eyes of the blessed become instruments which reflect the beauty and divinity of paradise. In the final four canti of the Paradiso, the pilgrim's eyes are changed and fortified, and his vision becomes all-encompassing, so that he has the ability to see all dimensions without the interference of perception of death. And this is the final quote. Inside the Imperium, where the laws of nature do not apply, Dante achieves perfect vision and is enabled to see all the heavenly hosts, including the angels, the fathers of the church, the Virgin Mary, and finally, the culmination of the Commedia, the pilgrim's eyes behold the Trinity. Throughout the Commedia, Dante employs vivid corporeal images which reveal the poet's philosophy, informed by his personal experiences as well as the theology of the church. Whether the shameful nakedness of the distorted shades of the Inferno or the brilliant glorified bodies of the Paradiso, images of the body serve to engage the reader who is invited to share the pilgrim's journey and to ultimately contemplate his own personal journey toward salvation. So I conclude with the words of W.S. Di Piero, who writes, quote, "It is in imitation of Christ that Dante lived without what may be the most acute, finely calibrated awareness of the body in modern and pre-modern literature," end quote. Thank you.
Our final presenter, Francesca Calamita, is assistant professor at the University of Virginia, where she teaches Italian studies and women, gender, and sexuality. She holds a PhD from Victoria University of Wellington and was a visiting fellow at the University of London. Her interdisciplinary research, transnational and anchored in feminist theory, investigates how women's relationship with food and body is portrayed in fiction, pop culture, advertisements, video performances, and films. Francesca is the author of a monograph on anorexia and bulimia in modern and contemporary Italian women's writing, Linguaggi dell'esperienza femminile, and co-editor of the volume Obsession, Starvation, and Identity, Studies in Contemporary Women's Writing. It appeared in this publication. She is currently working on a new edited collection in the area of food studies. Let's all welcome Professor Francesca Calamita.
Thank you very much, Annemarie, for the presentation, and thanks to the conference organizer for having accepted my paper. Over the last 20 years, Italy has experienced a growing number of migrants from Eastern Europe, Asia, the Middle East, and Africa, including, but not exclusively, former Italian colonies. Italy did not experience large-scale immigration after the decolonization of its territories, but more gradually from the 1970s onwards, when France, the Netherlands, and West Germany, following the oil crisis, start to reduce permits for migrants workers from their former colonies and territories, thus putting an end to their open-door policy on immigration. Over this year, Italy became an alternative European destination for migrants from the most diverse area of the globe. As Cristina Lombardi and Caterina Romeo point out in Postcolonial Italy, not only Italian culture lacks postcolonial consciousness, for the absence of significant immigration until more recent time, but also for its particular geographical collocation at the center of the Mediterranean Sea, pathway for many populations over the course of the history. Italy is currently one of the main ports of arrival to the European Union, thus still retaining its role as a crocevia towards migrants' final destination. Furthermore, the controversial principle of the jus sanguinis contribute to maintain the so-called Italianità, in contrast with the jus soli, which gives the right to anyone born in the territory of a state to become her or his citizen. In other words, as we all know, children of migrants are still considered migrants themselves, even if born in Italy. With the past and recent migration dynamics shaping a new identity, Italian as well as European, a new literary genre has also emerged, postcolonial Italian woman's writing. This new literary wave, which includes a group of black authors such as Nassera Crora, Fernanda Faria de Alburqueque, Ubax Cristina Ali Farah, and Igiaba Scego. Their marginal position because of their origins, race, gender, and often social class, and often sexual orientation, is discussed in their work, fictional and autobiographical, which also address contemporary debate on immigration. Scego was born in Rome in 1974. After her Somali parents immigrated to Italy following the 1969 coup d'etat. In her works, she widely discusses her Somali roots and Italian citizenship, navigating between two different culture and religion. She frequently denounced Italy's post-colonial past and its sexist and racist legacy in the present. In particular, in this presentation, I will focus on Salsicce. Salsicce is a short story written in 2003, where the young autobiographical Muslim protagonist negotiates her identity through food by eating pork meat, which is traditionally unlawful in accordance with Quran. Holding an Italian passport is not enough to make the protagonist feel safe, since her physical appearance does not conform to mainstream Italian women. Her future, therefore, will be always be that of an outsider. Framing my argument in feminist post-colonial studies, I will discuss the protagonist's troubled relationship with food as a sign of her desperate attempt to prove that she's a true or a conventional Italian girl, despite her black complexion and her religion. So, Scego starts her short story reflecting on the purchase that the protagonist has just made. And she says, la stranezza non è nell'oggetto comprato, ma nel soggetto compratore di salsicce. Io, me medesima, in persona, musulmana sunnita. With this remark, Igiaba highlights the tension between the object of desire, sausages, and the expectation placed on her as a Muslim woman, regardless of her citizenship. Her religious beliefs are also reminded to her by her shop seller, Rosetta, who knows personally the protagonist, and after her unusual request says, ma cara, ti sei convertita? Non era peccato per te mangiare salsicce? In this question embarrasses Igiaba, and she decides to reply that the sausages are not for her, but for someone else in the neighborhood. In this scene, the Italian shop seller feels entitled to speak and feels entitled to ask explanation, and Igiaba prefers not to say the truth. In other words, the white woman expresses her cultural privileges through this question and highlights the religious limitation experienced by the black woman. As Audre Lorde suggests, white woman privilege have been often achieved at the cost of their black counterparts. Igiaba's conversation with Rosetta is a modern example of this unequal relationship. This is not the first time Igiaba transgressed the rule imposed on her by her religion about eating. She remembered that while she was a child, she once by mistake ate some pork meat and was asked by her parents to vomit the insalata di riso, where tiny pieces of wurstel and sottaceti were mixed. Furthermore, the frying pan where the dish was prepared was also thrown away. Igiaba is not interested in eating sausages to taste their flour, but in potential effects they might have on her. And she says, se ingoio queste salsicce una per una, la gente lo capirà che sono italiana come loro, identica a loro. In other words, by buying them, Igiaba attempts to negotiate her identity. Purchasing salsicce, therefore, is a gesture of transgression, to feel closer to the culture of the country where she grew up. As in Margaret Atwood, The Edible Woman from 1969, one of the first Western novels where food is depicted as an instrument to question the patriarchal order, in Salsicce, Igiaba attempts to establish her persona through food. It is also interesting to note that exactly as in the biblical episode of Eve and the Apple, a woman, Igiaba, and food are on the scene. Like the apple, however, the salsicce have little to do with nutrition, but bring with them a different meaning. They represent transgression in accordance with Igiaba's religion and are forbidden exactly as the apple was for Eve. The reader finds themselves in front of a present-day story of disobedience where rules imposed by the patriarchal order affect a woman's behavior and might bring some form of punishment if not respect. Federica Angelini approached this correlation in her essay on food and migration. Yet the scholar links Igiaba transgression to la voglia di peccare. While I would suggest that Igiaba gestures like Eve are accomplished by the necessity of escaping the physical and cultural boundaries imposed on her by the patriarchy. This short story takes place in Silvio Berlusconi, Italy, at the time of the Bossi-Fini law, so 2002, which required fingerprints for all non-European Union immigrants. Igiaba believes that her excessive anxiety towards her identity originates from this new regulation. And in fact, she says, e io che ruolo avevo? Sarei stata un'extracomunitaria o un'italiana? Italia o Somalia? Impronte o non impronte? The protagonist is the owner of an Italian passport since she is older than 18 years old. While her legal citizenship cannot be questioned, she's unsure about her Italianità and how people perceive her due to her skin color and religion. In fact, she asks herself, ma ero davvero un'italiana nell'intimo? However, this is not the first time Igiaba deals with this issue. She remembered that when she was a child, many people were used to ask her if she preferred Italy or Somalia. Others try even more intimate questions. Ti senti più italiana o più somala? Eating the sausages, the protagonist has just bought at the butcher's means to feel more Italian than Somali, and therefore a way to remind herself and the people around her that she does not need to deposit her fingerprints, since she is a typical Italian woman, not only legally, but also in her eating habits. For a long time, Italianità has been defined by a series of unwritten rules in terms of skin color, religion, and habits, including those about food and clothing that still affect contemporary society. As Jacqueline Andal and Darren Duncan note, despite several decades of secularization, there have been multiple attempts to demarcate Italy as a Catholic country in recent time, an idea which has been also supported by several political parties such as the Lega, former Lega Nord, and Fratelli d'Italia, particularly after the terroristic attacks planned by ISIS, which have been taking place in Europe since early 2015. If Islamophobia has spread across the continent, dark skin color are also often associated with the other, and contrast with the relatively traditional European person with a fair complexion. This is particularly true in Italy, where mass immigration has been affecting society only in the last few decades. And as a consequence, complete immigration between races is still very difficult. For a long time, being Italian in Europe meant also being white, as it happened, for example, in the well-known 1996 episode of the first Black Miss Italy. The election of Danny Mendez, born in the Dominican Republic, caused a scandal through the nation for her origin, her dark complexion, and her hair that were not considered typically traits of Italian beauty. For her religion and her skin color, Igiaba feels an outsider. Therefore, the symbolic gesture of binding Salsicce acts as a cultural mediator between her heritage and her citizenship. Postcolonial feminist theories, such as the already mentioned Lorde and Adrienne Rich, have insisted for a long time on the importance of recognizing the privilege that white women have under the patriarchal order. If Igiaba was a white migrant, she could have faced identity issue, but in a less oppressive way. In other words, the Bossi-Fini law would have affected her in a different way, since people around her would not have mistakenly identified her as an extracomunitaria only for her skin color. Food is a fundamental marker of identity in every culture, and as Massimo Montanari suggests, è il primo modo per entrare in contatto con culture diverse. Other migrant writers have dealt with food in their narratives and have used it as a means of cultural negotiation. I'm referring in this context in particular to Curry di Pollo by Laila Vadia and also Il Cuoco di Alberia di Carmine Abate. Analyzing the elements that make her feel more Italian and less Somali and vice versa, Igiaba mentioned the following dish. Mi sento somala quando mangio la banana insieme al riso nello stesso piatto. Cuciniamo tutta quella carne con il riso o l'angilo. Mi sento italiana quando faccio una colazione dolce, mangio un gelato da 1,80 euro con la stracciatella, pistacchio e cocco senza panna. If food is a powerful tool to establish identity, by eating salsicce, Igiaba may metaphorically confirm her italianità and also feel more Italian than Somali and therefore eliminate the issue she's experiencing with the fingerprints. Forse, mangiando una salsiccia, passerei da impronte neutre a impronte vere, digitali, made in Italy. However, the protagonist is unable to taste the salsicce. She decides to steam them, but she doesn't like their colors and their smell. At the first bite, despite her effort, she actually says, "Non ho fatto in tempo a metterla in bocca, il vomito l'ha preceduta." The love-hate relationship Igiaba established with salsicce is a metaphor for her identity. She's open to Italian culture, but she does not want to delete her Somali origins. By eating pork meat, not only she will go against the rules imposed by Muslim religion, but also the habits and practice of her family. Non ho ancora deciso che cosa farò. Non ho ancora deciso se le mangerò, thinks the protagonist while watching television in a desperate effort to forget about this episode and her identity crisis. In the end, Igiaba decides not to eat the salsicce because with this gesture she won't solve her identity issue, and white Italian would still perceive her as an outsider. She admits to herself that she cannot be fully Italian or fully Somali, but a mix of these two cultures. No, sarei la stessa, e se questo dà fastidio, d'ora in poi io me ne porterò. While reflecting on her identity, Igiaba thinks also about several sociocultural issues that affect many African women, not only in Italy, but also in other countries, of course. Among others, she thinks about female genital mutilation. Procedure and age vary according to the ethnic groups of the country. From a Western feminist perspective, this practice marked by gender inequality is an attempt to control women's sexuality, including women's sexual pleasure, and impose on them ideas on purity and virginity. Igiaba, who did not undertake the procedure, is often questioned by her Somali relatives, who do not agree with her Western lifestyle in terms of sexual freedom. In fact, they say to her, ma tu sei impura, hai ancora il clitoride, non troverai mai un marito. The protagonist, however, embraces a more Western attitude towards it and states that l'infibulazione non ha niente a che fare con la religione, è solo una violenza sulle donne. Similarly, in Catholic religion, women have been marked as impure for premarital sex, and virginity has been regarded as a moral value for a long time. In both religion, patriarchal authority have imposed their power on women by controlling their bodies in an attempt to discipline their behaviors. At the same time, also food has been politicized by Muslim and Catholic religion. If pork meat is forbidden according to Quran, and Igiaba had to vomit the insalata di riso in order to be forgiven for erection, the so-called peccato di gola has also been marked as one of the worst sin by Catholic ideology. A lot of emphasis has been put on sweet food and the practice of fioretto, which impose on children abstinence from candies and chocolate in exchange for a fulfillment of a wish. Furthermore, Eve was the person who ate the apple rather than Adam, according to the collective imaginary. Therefore, women's relationship with food has been complicating since its early development and often associated with sin, lust, and misbehavior. In other words, regardless of the religion, Igiaba feel oppressed as a woman, and a way of eating as well as sexual freedom are imposed on her by the patriarchal authority. While it is true that she's not controlled by the patriarchal society as much as someone else could have been experienced in the past, it must be also said that the standards set by both religion in terms of eating and sexuality shape her identity. And to conclude, in Salsicce, Igiaba is unable to solve her dilemma with her double identity, neither Italian nor Somali. But she attempts to negotiate it through food. Food as an instrument of communication par excellence, a marker of identity between culture, and a powerful tool to express emotion and feelings are at the center of Igiaba Scego story. Refusing sausages means not to lose her Somali origin, but at the same time, this courageous gesture of binding them reveals an attempt to solve Igiaba's identity issue and assert her Italian national identity. As Vera Horn suggests, sin dall'inizio lei non è convinta della bravata. Entrambe le dimensioni, italiana e somala, fanno parte della sua identità, senza che l'una possa prevalere sull'altra o assimilarsi all'altra negandola. The fact that Igiaba does not choose between the two cultures is not a simple way to solve her issue, but on the contrary, a way to non obbedire a standard identitari rigidi, condizionati da un luogo o da paradigmi di classe, genere, sesso, etnia e razza. By reflecting on female genital mutilation, Igiaba also recognized that colonialism, gender and religion have often been contradictory for women, who have been at the same time colonized objects, but also colonizing subjects, which, however, are still controlled by the patriarchal order and their religion. At the end of the short story, Igiaba gets a phone call from a friend who let her know that she has won a concorso, senza segnalazioni, senza impronte digitali. And in this particular episode, Igiaba loves herself, a woman with a complex identity, where traits of Somali heritage and Italian citizenship cohabit together. Thank you.
My question is for Ms. Rorandelli, and I was wondering if you could share with us how old Ms. Masino was when she wrote the short story and what city she lived in when she worked and...
Yes, you're right, I didn't mention. She was born in Pisa, but she lived, well, in the 20s, she lived mostly in Paris. But she also lived in Rome. Her majority, you know, of her life was spent in Rome, except in 38 when her companion, Massimo Contempelli, a very famous intellectual, was sent to what's called, internal exile, so confino, by the regime. And so they spent some years in Venice. But, her home she would consider to be Rome, and to Rome a lot of her works are, you know, that's where a lot of her works are set. So the story, you know, it's not dated. I've dated it based on other texts that, you know, are within her diaries. One of the archivists who's studying Masino's archive, which, by the way, is in Rome at the Archivio del Novecento, Università La Sapienza di Roma, she believed it would be dated to the beginning of the 30s. So I'm approximating it to 33, 34. She was born 1908. So that would make her how old? Not even 30, I guess, in her 20s. And Rome was where the main headquarters of the, you know, obviously of the regime was, but also of the organization for the protection of mothers and infants, and so, you know, a big metropolis for the time as well. And definitely, you know, an interesting, I guess, opposition to, you know, the city where all the values are being uphold and, you know, what she's writing, which, as I mentioned, was treating also a topic that, not if you wrote about it in a literary, you know, setting, but if you carried out or helped in any way, an abortion would be, you know, punishable by law. And so it's, you know, it's what's what interested me when I you know, found the story was that it really spoke of all these topics that, you know, were considered taboo, and also that it was written probably at a time when the propaganda intensifies. You know, so we're in the culmine of this talk. So a lot of these texts, even Sileno Fabbri, one of the, you know, the second director of the Omni, wrote a text about, you know, the organization, and you know, and it was, you know, her story is a couple of years probably written after the penal code is in effect. So it's quite, you know, in that very important period of time. So I thought it was worth bringing to light, and I have to thank that. For that, the nephew of Paola Masino, who has kindly granted his permission for me to publish the story and publish it, and, you know, within an essay that I'm currently working on. So I would love some feedback on my paper as well. Thank you.
Thank you all. From early modern to 2017, this is a really beautifully organized panel. My question has to do again with the earlier short story. And the time in which it was published during the fascist era, and the fascist era's relationship with the Catholic Church. During this time period when women's bodies were being much more monitored, to say the least, what happened to the industry of the orphanages and the wet nursing, which was, you know, prominent all throughout Catholic Europe? Can you sort of contextualize that for me a little bit?
Yes. So just to clarify, the story was never published. So it was written, but, you know, has remained in the archive since. Yes. So the Organization for the Protection of Mothers and Infants, at the beginning, didn't want to supersede any of the opere pie or, you know, charitable associations and, you know, organizations that already were in existence way before, you know, the regime took hold of the nation. But so they existed in a parallel, you know, form. So they were still, you know, orphanages and places where women could have sought care. But more and more, and especially in 33, 34, when the Omni was reorganized in a much more centralized way, and it became much more fascist in its the members, and they had to all have the tessera, you know, be members of the Partito Nazionale Fascista. At that point, the Omni kind of starts taking hold of all those organizations. So they don't cease, but it, you know, starts superseding those. So it opened its own orphanages, case della madre del fanciullo, hospitals, and establishes a network where, for instance, women, like the woman protagonist, not the protagonist, but the servant who's, you know, one of the protagonists of the story, she would have been sent to one of these hospitals because not of means, she just was fired, single, mother of assumed to be illegitimate children, and the Omni would have taken care to probably try, not in this case, because she's clearly in the story, she's seduced and abandoned, the father is nowhere to be found, but the Omni would take it upon itself to help find the father in order to recreate the traditional family that it sought to, you know, propagandize. So it's taking, so, you know, so those same Catholic institutions are still there. The Omni starts taking more and more of a role. And especially in the early 30s, everything becomes much more bureaucratic and centralized because of the fear that, I mean, the data on infant mortality is quite high. Abortion, the data is mixed because they didn't have a good way of keeping, you know, tabs on what was going on. But we know that the preoccupation was demographic increase was not going to happen.
Thank you very much, everyone. And I kind of have like a crossover question between the last two presentations. In your presentation, we've seen like how the fascist regime has been imposing quite of a strong kind of like dogma upon like women's bodies, women's sexuality, the role of women in society. However, Italy has not escaped that kind of legacy yet. It's quite still of a patriarchal kind of society, and we still face kind of like a lot of discussions over like women's bodies and motherhood and kind of like women's role in society as mothers only. So I was wondering a bit about Francesca's presentation and Igiaba's role to this kind of Italian society, because I mean, she's facing the conundrum of being questioned whether she will find a husband because she didn't go through physical mutilation. However, is she questioning the relation to like how Italy sees like, or Italian society, the mainstream Italian society sees like women's bodies and how she interacts with this kind of like issues of, yeah, sexuality, gender.
I think she questioned both culture, but in a different way, you know, of course, remarking the different shade of both Italian culture and Somalian culture. In this short novel, she doesn't really question topics controlling women's body. Now, she feel empowered about her body, and she uses her body to try to eat the sausages, or maybe I'm not going to eat them, but she's in charge of it. However, I understand your question and what you, I mean, your comment in saying that what we see in this short, from what Tristana said to us, to my short story, is true that things have changed for controlling women's body, but the narrative is still there. And I mean, this is true on both sides of the Atlantic. We could open this topic, not only in the Italian culture, but also here. And I think I heard about this yesterday or 2 days ago, that in Ohio, they were trying to pass a law, or there was a proposal for tracking the health history of women who had an abortion. And I read it recently, and I'm not astonished. And like I say to my students of the time, it's not that tomorrow we will wake up and, oh, abortion rights have gone. But are these little things that are very problematic. So there's definitely a link between fascist time of Italy in the 1930s and 1940s and what we are living now.